Good morning, everyone. Myself, Mr. Manju Kiran, Assistant Professor, AJ Institute of Engineering and Technology. So, we were dealing with network layer. So, as of now, we have covered the topics like services provided by network layer, and then we have seen the addressing scheme used in network layer, that is IPv4 addressing. So we are seeing how the classful addressing and classless addressing scheme are used to assign the address to the users. So now with that, we'll move on to the next topic in that chapter, which deals with dynamic host configuration protocol, or in short we call it as DHCP, a protocol which is used in network layer to assign the address to the user automatically. So we have seen in case of classless or classful addressing scheme in IPv4, either an organization or an ISP will receive the block of addresses from ICANN, and ISP will give these addresses to the organization. So when this happens within the organization, the network administrator manually assign whatever the address received from ISP to the individual host or the routers in the organization. So it takes longer time in assigning the address manually to individual host or the routers. So to reduce this work, we use a protocol which is called as Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol. So this is the protocol used in the organization, so that this protocol automatically assigns the addresses for host and routers in the organization. Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol, or DHCP in short, is actually a application layer program, and using a client server paradigm that actually helps the TCP/IP at the network layer. This is also called as plug and play protocol. The network manager in an organization can configure this protocol to assign permanent IP addresses to the host and the routers. Even DHCP can also be configured to temporarily or on demand IP addresses to the host. So based on the requirement, so either the temporary IP addresses can be given to the host on demand. The other capability of DHCP is it can provide temporary IP addresses to the traveler to connect the laptop to the internet. For example, if any person who has come to a company and he want to access some data, then it is going to provide, that is DHCP is going to provide a temporary IP address, so that even that person can access the network and whatever the task has been given can be performed temporarily. It also allows the ISP with 1000 granted address to provide service up to 4000 households. So ISP with 1000 can provide the services up to 4000 people or customers, but at a time not more than 1/4 of the customers uses this internet, at the same time. So out of 4000, 1/4 is something, it is somewhere around 1000. So only 1000 customers should use at one instant of time. So this can be achieved by making use of this DHCP protocol. So when any system make use of DHCP, it should know, as you know, one thing is IP address. Along with that, even it should know the network prefix, or what we call it as mask. And most of the computers should also know other two informations, such as address of the default router. So which is the default router which will, through which it will able to communicate with other network. So address of that particular router, as well as address of the name server. So the name address of the main server to be used instead of address. So address of the name server to be able to use name instead of address. So it should know, the computer should know, one thing is network prefix, then also it should know the default router address as well as name of the server. So all these three information the system should know while it is using this dynamic host configuration protocol. So with this basics, we'll see how actually the communication takes place and what is the message format of DHCP. As I said, DHCP is a client server protocol in which client has to send a request message to the server, and server in return it is going to send a response message. So we'll see how exactly the message format in case of DHCP. So this is the diagram which shows the message format of DHCP. Now we'll go through each of the field in this DHCP message protocol. So as you can see here, so the first is the opcode. Okay, so this opcode will have is nothing but the operational code. So it will be either 1 or 2 based on the request or the reply. So if it is request, it is 1. If it is reply, it is 2. So that is for this opcode or operational code. Next, 8 bit for H type, which is nothing but hardware type, whether it is internet or not. So all those kind of information will be available in this particular H type. Next, from 16 to 24, that is remaining, once again the 8 bit will have information of length of the hardware address. So whatever I said here, H type is nothing but hardware type. So what is the length of that hardware address will be mentioned here. And the next one is H count, which stands for maximum number of hops the packet can travel. So then how many hops or the net switches or the routers the packet has to travel, that will be mentioned in this H count. Next, we have the next field, which is called as transaction ID. So the transaction ID is nothing but an integer. It is set by the client and repeated by the server. So whenever the data has been sent, so it will have a transaction ID. So it is the ID set by the client and it will be repeated by the server. The next field is time elapsed. It is nothing but the number of seconds since the client started to boot. So how much duration it takes to do the booting, so that will be mentioned in the time elapsed. Next field is flags. So in this particular data, the first bit will indicate unicast if it is 0, and if it is multicast then it will be 1. So this is 16 bit field. So if this is 0, then it is indicating unicast operation, and if it is 1, then it indicates multicast. Remember, it is only the first bit we'll be considering. Other 15 bits are not used. Next field is client IP address. So set to 0 if the client does not know it. So initial operation, whenever the operation begins, so initially the client will not be knowing any IP address because it has to request with the server. So initially it will be 0, and later case the IP address will be allocated. Next one is your IP address, the client IP address sent by the server. So as I said, so initially the client IP will be 0, and once the IP address sent by the server, so that address will be mentioned in this particular place. And the next field is gateway IP address. So gateway IP address is nothing but it is the address of default router. It is the address of a default router which is available in that network. I think we have missed server IP address. So server IP address is nothing but a broadcast IP address if client does not know it. So whatever the broadcast ID is there, that is same as this server IP address. Then we have server name, a 64 byte domain name of the server. So 64 bit, this is total 64 bit domain name of the server will be mentioned in the server name place. Next, boot file name. So it is 128 byte file name holding the extra information. And the next 64 byte is optional, which is used for dual purpose. Okay, so we have seen opcode, H type, that is hardware type, H LAN, that is length of the hardware address, followed by H count, stands for number of hops the packet has to travel, followed by transaction ID, an integer set by the client which is repeated by the server, followed by time elapsed, nothing but number of seconds since client started the boot. Next, flag, so which is going to indicate whether it is a unicast or a multicast. So only the first bit will be used. So 0 unicast, 1 multicast, rest 15 bits are not used. Followed by the address of the client, your IP address, server IP address, and gateway IP address. Then we'll have client hardware address. Then the name of the server. Then the file name, that is boot file name. And lastly, the option. So this option is nothing but 64 bit field with a dual purpose. So we'll see what is this optional field in detail now. So this 64 byte optional field, as I said, has got dual purpose. So it may contain either the additional information or some specific information related to vendor. So it can be used for both. Usually the server uses a number which is called as magic cookie in the format of an IP address with a value 99.130.83.99. So when client finishes reading the message, so it looks for the magic cookie. If that present, then the next 60 bytes are optional bits. So optional bits or optional whatever you have, that is 64 byte, will have mainly three fields. The first 1 byte will have the tag field. The first 1 byte is nothing but tag field. Then the second 1 byte will be the length field, and the third one is variable length value field. So I repeat, so the optional consists of three fields. So 1 byte of tag field, 1 byte of length field, and third one is variable length value field. So it is a 3 field in the optional. So there are several tag fields that are used by the vendor. So based on different vendors, so the tags will be different. If the tag field is 53, the value field defines one of the 8 messages type as shown here. So we can see here in the next slide, you can see here the first tag bit is 53. So once the tag bit is 53, then the value field defines one of the 8 messages. So the value 1, it is going to define one particular value. If it is 2, it is going to define one particular value as shown in this slide. So 1 is for DHCP discover, 2 for DHCP offer, 3rd DHCP request, 4th DHCP decline, 5th DHCP acknowledge, 6th DHCP negative acknowledge, 8th DHCP release, and the final one, 8th one, DHCP inform. So with this 8 types of optional, with this 8 different types, we'll see how the data will be communicated between the server and the client. So we'll see how the DHCP operation takes place using different optional field. So you can see the first one here. So in case one, let me take case one, that is at this particular field, the host, whichever you want to join the server, has to create DHCP discover message in which only the transaction ID field is set to a random number. So you can see here that here in this case it is 1001. So once this transaction ID, which is a random number, is given, then the rest of the fields like lease time, client address, your address, server address, these 4 are empty. So no other field can be set because host has no information, because this is the initial setup, so it will not have any other information. Then this message is encapsulated in UDP datagram with source address 68 and destination port set to 67. So it will give some port address for the source as well as destination, and it is encapsulated in UDP datagram. Then the user datagram is encapsulated in an IP datagram. So with the source address, as shown, you can see here it is 0.0.0.0, and the destination address will be set to 255.255.255.255, which is nothing but a broadcast address. The reason why we are using the source address all zeros and destination address all 255 is, so before joining the host, it will not be knowing its own address or the server address. So it is a try by the client to have a link with the server. So this is the first step, which is called as DHCP discover. So once this DHCP discover message has been sent, then the DHCP server or server, so you might have more than one servers, so they are going to respond with DHCP offer message. So it is DHCP offer message in which the your address field, so that will be mentioned, which will be defines the offered IP address for joining that particular server, and server's address field includes the IP address of the server. So it is going to add your address, that is the address of the host, as well as the address of the server. So all those data will be included in the message. The message will also includes one more field, which is called as lease time, for which the host can keep the IP address, the duration for which the IP address the host can keep it. And once all these data have been entered, the message is encapsulated back in user datagram with the same port address specified by DHCP discover message, but it will be in reverse. So once all this is done, the datagram with the server address and source address will be sent back to the DHCP discover, that is to the client. So all those data will be entered and it is encapsulated in a datagram and it will be broadcasted. So those who want to have the help or to use the server can view this particular message. So we have seen two operations. First one is DHCP discover, wherein client searching for the server through some temporary ID which specifies its port, source address as well as destination address, with a source address equal to all the fields equal to 0, and in the destination address all the data having 255, the broadcast address. So once it is received by any of the server or the servers, then in reply to the DHCP discover, they are going to send a message, as you can see here, which is called as DHCP offer. In this, it is going to send, or it is going to mention the your address as well as the server address. Your address is nothing but the address which is allotted to or given to the client. Server address is the address of the server. Then it is going to give the source address as well as the destination address, and it is going to mention the lease time, the duration for which the server can be used, and it will be sent back in the network. So who are the client who want to use this particular server can make a note of this. Next, the third operation, which is called as DHCP request. So in return to DHCP offer, the host which want to join will receive one or more offer from the multiple servers, if it has got multiple servers, and select which is the best for it. So the joining host, then it is going to send DHCP request message to the server to which it want to join. So once it is done, while it is doing so, it is going to set the known values, that is whatever the address it has been given as a source address, that will be noted as source address, and the user datagram is encapsulated in an IP datagram with this source address, and the destination address will be same as the previous case, that is 255.255.255.255. That is a broadcast address. This is because to tell or to let the other servers know that their offer was not accepted, only this has accepted the offer from this particular server. So rest all the data, so transaction ID, lease time, server address, all those things as including the port address, that is source as well as destination address, will remain same. So with this, the server is going to receive the data from the client, that is DHCP request frame, or the message will be received by the corresponding server. Once this data is sent, the selected server responds with DHCP ACK. So it is an acknowledgement from the accepted server. So this is the message to the client if the offered IP address is valid. So whatever the IP address has been offered to that particular client, if it is valid in the requested message, then it is going to send DHCP ACK message. So if the server cannot keep up the offer, so if it is not able to keep up the offer, then it is going to send DHCP NACK, that is DHCP negative acknowledgement, so telling that it cannot connect to the server. So the client need to check for some other service, or it has to wait for some time, and once again it has to repeat this process. This message is also a broadcast to let other servers know that request is accepted or rejected. So since once again it is a broadcast message, so information will be shared with all other servers so that other servers will come to know that which client has been connected to that server or which clients are not connected to that particular server. So this is how the DHCP operation will take place, or this is how the addresses will be assigned using DHCP protocol. I'll repeat this once again. So initially the request will be sent by the client through the frame or a message called DHCP discover with a transaction ID with server source port as well as destination port, with source address having 0.0.0.0 and the destination address having the broadcast address, that is 255.255.255.255, and it is going to send a broadcast message. So the server within that particular area, or if it is multiple servers, they are going to get this frame, and whichever want to offer the service, then in response to DHCP discover, it is going to send a DHCP offer frame mentioning the source address which it can use and the destination address as well as the lease time, that is the time duration for which the server can use it, with the same source and destination port, but it is in reverse, and it will be sent to the client. So once it is received from the client, then it is going to send the request with mentioning whatever the source address has been given from the server, and it will be sent back to the server. Once it is received by the server, based on the availability, it might send DHCP ACK or DHCP NACK, that is positive acknowledgement or the negative acknowledgement to the client. So if it is positive acknowledgement, then the client can connect with the server with a given source port as well as with the source address given. If the negative acknowledgement has been sent, that is DHCP NACK has been sent from the server, then the client has to search for some other server, or it has to wait till it gets once again the chance with the same server. Both the client as well as server is going to send a broadcast message once a client get a server, or server gets a client, saying that, or it is informing to the rest of the system in the network that a particular client has been connected to a particular server, or a server indicating to the rest of the server that it has got this particular client connected to the server. With this, I have come to the end of DHCP protocol. So examination point of view, this topic is very very important. So we can go through the DHCP protocol, especially the operation of DHCP protocol. So you should draw this diagram, and you need to explain in detail how exactly the DHCP operation takes place. If you have any doubt regarding this, you can get back to me and clarify your doubts. Thank you.